government of Guyana last month arrived at the middle of its term, and never mindful of its duty to the people, we continue to aim at providing a good life for all next year and right through to 2020. The nation's economy has been prudently managed over the past 30 months when compared particularly with some of the distress that other countries have been enduring. This prudence has allowed for moderate economic growth of 3.1% in 2015 and 3.3% in 2016, despite the unfavorable external environment. And as you realize, many of our neighbors have been flocking to Guyana. There are over 20 Surinamese companies in Guyana. There are several huge Trinidadian companies in Guyana. And there's a reason why they're coming. There's a reason why they're coming. Because Guyana is growing. They don't come to lose money. The government has adopted measures to improve the living standards of workers. Public servants' minimum wage increased by over 50% within the past 26 months. The income tax rate was reduced and the income tax threshold increased by a minimum of 20%. And these measures boosted workers' disposable income, the take-home pay. The government will continue to support all sectors of the economy. And we are particularly concerned about the sugar industry and, of course, the sugar workers. The government has provided $31 billion in financial support for the Guyana Sugar Corporation. Because we are concerned with protecting workers' livelihood, we understand the plight of workers, and we did not want to take any rash decisions which would jeopardize their quality of life. But at the same time, we have to arrest the financial hemorrhaging of the industry. And I think you've got within your package a copy of the state paper or white paper on the sugar industry. You can see from that paper that the sugar industry is not being shut down. It is being consolidated, and we hope to have three mega estates, one in East Babis, one in West Babis, and one in West Demerara. And we want to make those three mega estates viable and profitable. The government is pursuing every option and every opportunity to ensure that the industry remains viable. We are quite appreciative of the impact it will have on the rural economy and, of course, the rural population. Still along the lines of our economy, the government has been working to improve national economic competitiveness. We have reduced the corporation tax rate for manufacturing and non-commercial companies from 30% to 27.5%. We would like to see more manufacturing, and one of our measures has been to restrict the import of pine wood so that local wood producers, local furniture manufacturers could have a greater share of the market. And we hope that persons who bring in all these plastic goods would give way so that we could encourage local manufacturers producing bags and producing biodegradable materials. The value-added tax has been reduced to 14%. And the VAT threshold has been increased from 10 million to 15 million. The government is rebalancing the economy through its support for micro, small, and medium scale enterprises. Some people call it the plant and chip economy. But I'd like those same people to go to the regional exhibitions which we've been holding around the country and see women coming out of Upokari and Hiawa, see housewives getting into the microeconomy, and you can see that there's something happening in Guyana. It may start with planting chips. I know somebody who started off producing producers at Temeri. And today, those fruit juices are being bottled or boxed as Temeri Orchard Products Company, TOPCO. So small things could end up big. Loans and grants have been issued under the Hinton Employment Youth Scheme, the Linden Enterprise Network, the Micro and Small Enterprise Development, Sustainable Livelihoods and Entrepreneurial Development, the Women of Worth Initiative, and the People of Worth Entrepreneurial Resources Initiative. And it's very encouraging to meet persons who have made use of these schemes. As you recall, with the launch of the SLED initiative, one woman who was a graduate of the New Opportunity Corps boasted that she's been able to turn her life around because of these initiatives. Ladies and gentlemen of the media, the government continued to build its institutional capacity and adoption of an appropriate legislative and regulatory framework for sustainable management of our natural resources sector, including the emerging petroleum sector. And of course, we're seeking the best advice to enable us to adopt the best international practices. The government has been strengthening the regulatory framework of the information and communication technology sector, digitizing education, establishing ICT hubs. And again, if you go to Cyril Potter College of Education, you'll discover that the entire compound, I believe, is now accessible by Wi-Fi. And this is going to extend over the coming years to all government institutions. Greater emphasis is being placed on liberalization and regulation of telecommunications. And we expect that through the enactment of appropriate legislation, we'll see telecoms penetrating all of the corners of Guyana. The government is improving the country's transportation network of aerodromes, bridges, roads, stellings, and wharves. The four-lane extension of the East Bank Demerara Public Road has been completed. Village roads measuring over 100 kilometers have been constructed or repaired. More than 30 hinterland aerodromes have been rehabilitated and maintained. And as we go forward into 2018, this program will continue. The government has restored the people's participation in local decision making. As you know, up to this time in 2014, I would have been on the road out there, and some of you might have paid me a visit. I was picketing the then administration to hold local government elections, anticipating that I'd come off the road into this building, which I did. And I was able to ensure that local government elections have been held. We've established 3 new towns. When last has this happened? Editors of popular newspapers who grew up at Bartica would now know that Bartica is a town. Mabroom is a town, Lethem is a town, Mari would become a town. The idea is that every region should be administered by a capital town. No one should have to leave his or her region to get any public service, whether it's NIS, whether it's passport, whatever the government service is. People should be able to get that service within the region of their residence. As you know, up to quite recently, if you wanted to register a business at Lethem, you had to go to Adventure on the Essequibo Coast. If you had to collect child support at Wisma, you had to go to Vredenhoek. Or if you were at Kokwani, you had to go to Lethem. So things are changing. And we feel that with the establishment of these capital towns, residents of every region would be able to transact business within those regions. Plans of action for regional development have been developed for every region. And we have started a program of regional agricultural commercial exhibitions. This is the plant and chip economy people speak about. But you go to one of them, and you'll see that supermarkets now are buying those same planting chips. They're buying the farine, they're buying the tamarind balls, they're buying cashew nuts. So I'm very proud that our local supermarkets are in fact encouraging products at the household and community level. And in part, it is because of these regional agricultural and commercial exhibitions, RACE, which so far for this year, six regions have held. Only four regions have not held agricultural and commercial exhibition, whatever name they're called. They're very useful in developing our concept of the promotion of micro-enterprise, household and cottage industries. The government expanded the provision of water to unserved communities and improved the quality of service. The commencement of the water supply and sanitation improvement program will benefit more than 50,000 consumers. The government over the past 30 months has aimed its efforts at reaching a peaceful resolution to the international or the territorial controversy with the Bolivarian Republic of Venezuela. As you know, this process is almost entirely in the hands of the Secretary General of the United Nations, and he has appointed a personal representative, Mr. Doug Nulander, and our Minister of Foreign Affairs has been engaged with Mr. Nulander for much of this year. I met him myself, and I met the Secretary General in September. The government has also strengthened the financial regulatory framework in order to insulate our economy from the proceeds of illicit activities. As you know, money laundering and contraband smuggling have been taking a toll on our economy. The promulgation of anti-money laundering and countering the financing of terrorism legislation will provide greater safeguards and stronger enforcement to ensure the integrity of our financial system. Still in governance, the government has reestablished and made appointments to institutions required by the Constitution. The appointments of Chairman of the Guyana Election Commission and an Ombudsman, the establishment of the Public Procurement Commission, and the reestablishment of the Public Service Appellate Tribunal are manifestations of our commitment to abide by the Constitution. The government is committed to improving conditions in the public education system, a system under which teachers study, work, and live, under which students have to attend school. Improvement in education attainment requires investment in teacher training. And those of you who heard me yesterday would know of our commitment to improving the Shilpata College of Education. We were very fortunate to have a grant valued about 50 million Guyana dollars. All of it went to science laboratories at the Shilpata College of Education. Over 1,000 teachers have been trained over the past 3 years. The number of trained teachers in our schools has increased and now stands at about 77%. The government, in pursuit of the common good, continue to pursue the vision of a Guyana in which diversities are embraced, differences are respected, and conflicts are resolved. We have developed a national strategic plan to foster greater social harmony and social cohesion, and to prevent people from dividing with an eye of society. The government has improved the reach, quality, and administration of passport, immigration, birth, marriage, and death registration services. We've reduced the processing times for the issuance of passports, and the service is being decentralized to all six capital towns. The government continues to support indigenous communities, of which there are about 215. These communities have benefited from a range of community service initiatives, including presidential grants, the distribution of school uniforms, the construction of community centers, and the provision of all-terrain vehicles, boats, and outboard engines. The government has embarked on a process of reform and is revamping the national security architecture. With the assistance of the United Kingdom, we will establish a Department of Security Sector Reform within this ministry. The security forces are gradually recovering from the demoralization which was inflicted on them during the Troubles in the first decade of this century. The government has promulgated a National Drug Strategy Master Plan, which is resulting in many more arrests, including two additions of aircraft to our national fleet. We've established a National Anti-Narcotics Agency, and we've also established a National Intelligence and Security Agency, and re-established the National Security Committee, which meets every week. Ladies and gentlemen of the media, your country is in transition to becoming a green state. The government has established the Department of Environment to coordinate and regulate the national effort in this trust. Your government will continue to place emphasis on the preservation of our biodiversity and the protection of the environment. The protected area system will be expanded by an additional 2 million hectares, as you know. I've already made this commitment at the United Nations. Government buildings increasingly are going to be powered by alternative sources of energy as part of our green agenda. Thank you.